Good evening, everyone. My name is Kiyohiko Toyama. I'm a member of the Japanese Parliament and also a member of the New Economic Party. I'm very nervous after hearing how wonderful audience I have tonight. And I'm, of course, very honored to be given this opportunity to share my views about the future of Japan-China relations with everyone here today. For this, I'd like to note my gratitude to this university for organizing this event, and particularly to Robert who kindly coordinated this. Before I begin to talk on the topic, let me introduce myself briefly and also let me make a few things clear. I was originally graduated from Soka University in Hachioji, Tokyo. I spent 1 year at the University of Glasgow in Scotland, and after that I moved on to study peace studies at the University of Bradford in North England. And I spent 4 years and 3 months there, gained MA and PhD degrees in the field of peace studies. So, as an academic, I was not an expert on China or Japan-China relations originally. I was more like concerned about the peace building, peace making businesses. And after coming back from England in 1998, I took the position of lecturer in political science and international relations at the University of Miyazaki International College in the southern part of Kyushu. There I taught as a lecturer, and also I became an advisor for the Japanese international NGO called Peace Wins Japan, which was founded by Mr. Kensuke Onishi, also the founder of Japan Platform, the NGO's conglomerate in Japan, who happened to be my classmate in England years. Anyway, after that, I came to Japanese politics about 11 years ago by mistake, because you don't need a British PhD to become a Japanese politician. But I have been in on and off the parliament, because I spent outside the parliament for 1 year and 7 months between 2008 and 2010. Otherwise, I have been always around in the parliament. I experienced the ruling side for 7 years as a member of the upper house of the Japanese parliament, during which time I was once appointed by Prime Minister Koizumi to be the junior vice minister of foreign affairs. And that's the point, year 2006, I made a very strong connection with Chinese affairs, because as a senior member of the foreign office of the Japanese government, I was responsible for Chinese affairs. Now, a few things for you to note. First, I currently hold a position as the Director of International Affairs of New Komeito, which is, as you may know, the third largest political party at the moment in the Japanese Diet. But what I'm going to say tonight, all of it, does not represent the views of the party. It's all personal. Second, although I have earned, as I mentioned, MA and PhD degrees in England, my English capabilities have weighed down over the last decade, since particularly after I entered Japanese politics. Because we don't operate in English in the parliament. So please accept my deep apologies beforehand in case I speak something incomprehensible in English. And please don't ask any complicated, difficult questions later in the question and answer session. Also, I'd like to point out that I'm originally from the world of academia. I deliberately made today's presentation not as academic, but something more like a politician's brainstorming on the issues. So I hope you can agree to that. And lastly, at the moment, many Japanese citizens are more concerned about the issue of consumer tax rates bills and last Friday's agreement among the DPJ, LDP, and my party on them. So, of course, my mind also tends to go over to those issues right now. Let us try to stick to the predetermined topic of Japan-China relations tonight. Your cooperation on this point would be much appreciated later. So, by the way, before I speak about my presentation, let me just very quickly explain a set of documents distributed among yourselves today. This is not what I produced. It's papers from Japanese Foreign Ministry. But just I prepared this just in case that you're bored with my talk. So there are some interesting statistics and the history, recent history of the relationship between two countries. So you can look at that at any point. So anyway, my first, what I'm going to talk first is the image of China today. My image of China is a very complicated one. China is so huge, a country with a huge population of 1.3 billion people, and also a country of long history and tradition. China's urban areas have changed dramatically over the last two decades, but the rural areas that I visited have mostly remained as poor agricultural area. China, as if I remember correctly, has around 54 ethnic groups in the country, and the number of incidents involving organized violence has been on increase for the last 10 years. According to the data from a Japanese source, the average number of such organized violent incidents in entire China in 2008 exceeds 210 per day. So which means every day somewhere in China, there are on average more than 210 violent incidents happen every day. So we have to remember that when you actually analyze the deeds and statements of the Chinese leaders, even when they talk about foreign policy. Anyway, we will come back to that later. So China today is one of those countries in the world that cannot be discussed in a singular term. We often say, China argues blah, 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 or Beijing thinks blah, blah, blah. But who represents China? Who is Beijing? So to answer those questions is already a very difficult one. And this difficulty is getting enhanced over the last decade as Chinese society itself further diversifies. There are many key players in Chinese politics and society today. Senior members of Communist Party, senior members of business community in China, senior members of People's Liberation Army, and even young internet bloggers. So therefore, it is increasingly difficult now for Japanese politicians like me to grasp the true posture, the reality, real China, if any. But having said that, for the sake of leading to a meaningful discussion later on, I'd like to present before you the following major points to consider about China present and also Japan's relations with the country in the years to come, even at the risk of overgeneralization. So please allow me to do that. Now, next I'd like to talk about economic aspect of China. China is now the second biggest GDP in the world after the United States, and its economy continues to grow at an annual rate of around 10% or recently for the last 2 years, right, around 8%. Anyway, it's very high ratio anyway. In Japan, I mean, we Japanese politicians aim at a very humble target of 2% annual growth, but we've never achieved that for the last 10 years or more.
But interestingly, oh, it's gone. Interestingly, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sure, okay, fine. Yeah. Until around 10 years ago, the thesis, that China is a growing threat to Japanese economy has been, it's indicator is gone, so which means everything is gone.
Right? Is it battery?
Okay. Fine. Okay. New one. So, 10 years ago, there was a popular view that China is getting a threat to Japanese economy among the Japanese citizens. Probably the major reason being that our Japanese factories and employment would be deprived by the Chinese. But interestingly enough, 10 years later, now, such a view is almost gone. Of course, this does not mean that the mutual trust and friendly feelings between the two nations have improved. In fact, I think they worsened. According to Japan's Cabinet Office's regular opinion survey, Japanese grassroots affinity toward China went down dramatically from 47.2% in year 2000 to 26.3% last year. So this means that more than 70% of the Japanese citizens now harbor some kind of uncomfortable feelings, if not angry feelings, towards China. I don't have accurate data on the Chinese side about this point, but I believe the other side, the Chinese side, would probably show the same kind of tendency over the last few years. This growing distrust between two nations at the grassroots level is deeply connected to a number of recent incidents, such as Chinese fishery boats attacking on Japanese Coast Guard vessel offshore Senkaku Islands in 2009. But I will just stop analyzing these incidents at this point. Because what I'd like to stress here in connection with the economic aspect is that the Japanese, we have now widely accepted the reality of China as an economically bigger neighbor and try not to see this new China, economically bigger China, as a threat to Japan, but as a new challenging ground or market to sustain or even lift up a weakening Japanese economy. Today, China is not the mere base of Japanese companies' factories that can manufacture things at the cheaper labor cost. China is now number one trade partner for Japan. The total volume of Japan-China trade being $301.9 billion per year, excluding Hong Kong. For your reference, by the way, the present volume of Japan-US trade is merely $185.5 billion. So Japan-China trade is much, much bigger, almost double of that of Japan-US trade today. And of course, for China, Japan remains number three trade partner, the biggest one being United States. Besides, China is now increasingly viewed as a huge new market for Japanese products with a 1.3 billion population. Putting aside recent other factors such as European financial crisis, Japan has, as we all know, long suffered economic recession,
due to seemingly never-ending deflation. Deflation, I'm not an expert on economics, but I'm sorry, but deflation, as I understand it, is partly a result of our continuous demand-supply gap. In other words, Japanese current demand level is short of about 10 trillion yen every year against the supply level. So in theory, Japanese deflation right now does not end until this 10 trillion yen worth gap is filled by a new demand from the market. From this point of view, the fast-growing Chinese market is expected by many people, including politicians, to generate a large part of this new demand, which we really wanted to overcome present situation. This thinking, by the way, is in accord with the recent news that utilizing overly enhanced strong yen, now some Japanese big corporations, convenience store networks, supermarkets, etc., expand their investments in China. So whether you like or dislike China, that is a personal choice, but economically speaking, China is arguably one of the most important countries to the future of Japanese economy. In the coming few decades at least, I think that the nature of Japan-China relations in economy and business will be the biggest single element affecting the growth of Japanese economy. Let me move on to the issue of huge population in China. As already mentioned, China has a huge population of 1.3 billion. Some people say the actual number is bigger because there are many unregistered children in countryside or even downtowns of the big cities like Shanghai. So nobody knows the accurate figure of the Chinese population. Anyway, this size of population constitutes a basis of national power. So in this sense, China's prosperity and international influence depend upon this number. But as you know, the huge population also bring a number of difficult problems, particularly for politicians. Widening discrepancy in wealth among Chinese people themselves is one such issue. On this issue, I'd like to share my interesting experience with you. 2 years ago, I visited China twice. The first occasion, which came in September 2010. I was invited by the Chinese Communist Party to an international conference between Asian political parties held in the city of Kunming, Hunan province. And the scene of that international conference among the political parties was poverty eradication. What I remember from attending this conference is that the Chinese political leaders really wanted to show to other countries' politicians and probably also to domestic mass media and also the ordinary Chinese people through the media how hard they, the Chinese leader, try to eradicate poverty in their own society and deliver necessary support for those in extreme situation. So there was an excursion, short trip, into poverty zones of the Kunming, city of Kunming, which was organized by the Chinese authority as an official program attached to the conference. Of course, one can argue that it may be the classic case of a carefully calculated political performance to impress rather innocent guests from other countries. But actually, I was impressed. Although I do not regard myself as some innocent political character. But I was impressed. Why? Because I was impressed because I saw a half truthfulness in the problem of the poverty in China. And because the Chinese authority today is so confident enough to show this problem, poverty problem, very candidly to the politicians of other countries. I think this sort of behavior on the part of the Chinese leaders would have been unimaginable 20 years ago. So that was my first interesting experience. And second one came in December, the same year, 2 years ago. I accompanied, as the Director of International Affairs of the party, my party leader, Mr. Natsuo Yamaguchi, on his official visit to China. We were able to meet Vice President Xi Jinping, who probably will become the president of China October this year, probably, during our stay in Beijing. Mr. Xi Jinping's statements in the latter part of our meeting, well, actually meeting between Mr. Xi and Mr. Yamaguchi, really surprised me. In essence, what he told us in that meeting is as follows. I quote, he said, "Nearly 30 years have passed since China initiated the policy of political reform and opening market. During these decades, China has achieved outstanding outcomes, but we see them with calm. China's per capita GDP is still one-tenth of Japan's," unquote. So, by saying this, Vice President Xi seemed to want to stress that China was still a developing country, not an advanced developed country yet. And he went on to say the following. I quote, "The total Chinese population is actually almost equal to the total population of all developed countries, 1.3 billion, of course. What would happen," he said, "to global resources and ecology if every Chinese national citizen start living like a citizen in Japan, in those developed countries?" He said, "It is possible that this planet, this earth, cannot sustain such a situation." In today's China, he continues, "the living standard of about 150 million people is below the United Nations defined lowest level of poverty. So unbalanced development of China has produced discrepancy of wealth between urban areas and agricultural areas. We still have a long road ahead towards true modernization," unquote. So I was surprised not only at the candidness of this vice president, but also at the implications of his statement. Being a politician myself, I instantly understand an implied agony of the Chinese leaders. On the one hand, as a Chinese leader, senior leader of Chinese Communist Party, Xi Jinping probably wants to make China a country that can deliver and safeguard the same kind of living standards that we in developed countries today enjoy. On the other hand, Vice President clearly knew that the realization of that goal bring devastating consequences to our planet as a whole. So it is, of course, as you know, it is politically right for any leader of any country to make his own country more affluent. But in case of China, this is not a simple political question, but it's an ethical one, because it would mean the devastation of the planet as a whole. So he mentioned that in the summit top meeting between my party leader, and himself. So I think recognizing the existence of this kind of peculiar, special kind of problems in China today, I believe, is quite important for analyzing, focusing on Chinese future, and of course our relationship with them. After this meeting in Beijing, I began to support more strongly the idea that vital global issues such as environment or limited natural resources, those vital global issues must be discussed with hugely populated developing countries such as China, India, or Brazil. So in this sense, I think the G20 framework, rather than G8, should play a larger role in the coming years on the matters, common problems of international community. And next, I'd like to talk about changing China's foreign policy in the recent decades. In terms of political system, there are not many similarities between Japan and China, as we all know. Chinese Communist Party, with its about 70 million party members, takes leadership in all aspects of Chinese political and administrative matters, including foreign policy. So 1.3 billion China is actually under the leadership of Chinese Communist Party with its membership 70 million only, which is not really popularly known in Japan. Anyway, the foreign policy. Main characteristic of Chinese foreign policy is probably its strategic nature. With its political stability, which is guaranteed by single-party dominance, China seems to be able to conduct foreign policies more strategically than, I'm afraid to say, Japan in the long term. As you know, after the Koizumi administration, Japan has suffered the visible loss of long-term strategy due mainly to frequent change of premier every year. I don't believe that everyone here would remember the last five prime ministers' names of Japan. Even I sometimes tend to forget who is after Fukuda or who is before Noda, you know, it's difficult. Anyway, it's a half joke. Until mid-1990s, China had concentrated its resources into domestic development until mid-1990s. But after, I mean, changing point came around 1996 and 1998. That is a time when China suddenly established a partnership relationship with Russia in 1996, with United States 1997, and with Japan in 1998. So it's China's foreign policy became gradually strategic with a view to promoting its national interests through more active maneuver and engagement on international theater. At the outset of the 21st century, with its fast-growing economic power and political influence, China's engagement further intensified in the regions of Central Asia, Southeast Asia, Korean Peninsula, leading first to the establishment of Shanghai Cooperation Organization in 2001. 2 years later, in order to deal with very serious, difficult North Korean-related problems, including nuclear development issue and the four Japanese abduction problem, the related major countries created, as you know, six-party talks, and we placed China in the chairman's seat. Around the same time, China's influence was largely enhanced over the ASEAN countries through participating more actively in the ASEAN regional forum and also bilateral cooperation between China and every ASEAN countries. So in the face of rising China in all aspects of international society, China is demanded by others in international society to behave more as a responsible stakeholder country. Whether China has really become a responsible stakeholder or not remains to be an object of discussion among experts. But China's influence after the beginning of this new century is difficult to ignore. And growing China's international presence seems to have brought significant changes inside China's foreign strategy and policies. After 2006, within the political circles of China, the definition of national interest was reviewed and reconsidered so as to clearly include the protection of national sovereignty, national security, and developing interests. In addition, the Chinese leaders began to use the expression of vital national interest more often than before, in Japanese, kakushinteki rieki, after 2006. They did that in order to assert more vividly, more crystal clearly, their own strategic goals to international community. So we have to bear in mind that the China, as we see today, is more assertive, active, and strategic international power, which seeks to maximize its national interests. Today, of course, in other areas, China's influence can be felt almost everywhere in the world. Other Japanese politicians, I have come across the buildings and the infrastructures built on the Chinese aid money in South Pacific Islands, a huge quantity of Chinese products in the street markets of Europe and Middle East, and Japanese international businessmen came to me to complain about much greater Chinese influence in the energy market of African continent, and etc. So all in all, we have to comprehend and deal with these realities when forming our policies toward China. And now, Robert came here to stop me.
No. Pretty soon we'll want to have Q&A.
Okay, fine.
Because I know there are lots of questions.
Okay, so I will summarize. Yes. Fine. So, my conclusion. My conclusion is that we are partners. I mean, China and Japan are partners. And unfortunately, many people in Japan today do not see China as friends. But I hope that maybe we need some time to do this. But I personally want to see a situation in which that more Japanese people would see China as a friend. Because if we are friends, there must be friendship. Of course, sometimes we have a severe argument among the friends, but usually if there is a friend, you don't expect your friend to attack you. So I think in order to become friends, I would like to present the following efforts. That's my conclusion. Can I have 5 minutes? All right, fine. First, we must strengthen our strategic partnerships through continuous dialogues at all levels of administration, including defense-related sectors. Second, we must reduce security risks through making our military budgets and capabilities as transparent as possible. On this particular point, China, not Japan, needs much more effort. Chinese military spending has increased dramatically since 1989, and its accurate volume is still unknown. Also, we need to firmly establish a maritime communication mechanism in order to avoid unnecessary crisis in the sea between our territorial waters. Third, both governments should make more efforts to promote exchanges between ordinary people of both countries. Yes, on this point, I would like to say one thing. Last year, I met one young, famous Chinese internet blogger in Tokyo who was relatively, who had a wide experience with international society. He came from New York to Tokyo. Nonetheless, it was his very first visit to Japan. I was honestly astonished to hear from him the following line. He said, Mr. Toyama, before I came to Japan, I firmly believed that I would be followed 24 hours a day by a secret Japanese police agent while staying in Tokyo. But after 2 weeks, no one seems to follow me. So he said, now I can say with confidence, Japan is an unexpectedly free and democratic country. From a young Chinese man. I didn't get angry, but I was surprised. So many Chinese are still misread about Japan by certain TV programs and biased education programs. I think that's true. From the viewpoint of free expression, it is okay for any Chinese citizen or programs to criticize Japan for its past deeds and others. But the deliberate propagation of inaccurate image of today's Japan, if still being promoted, is just completely unproductive. I would like the Chinese government to take all necessary measures to improve on these issues. And the last 2 points. Fourth, we need to widen the policy fields where both countries can benefit from a closer cooperation. For example, China can benefit enormously from Japanese experience of tackling pollution problems and can use our findings and technologies not only for the Chinese themselves, but also for the countries that China is now aiding. And last point, we need to address regional and global problems in a more integrated way between each other. For Japan, Chinese assistance is very helpful to find solutions on North Korea-related problems, including abduction issue, of course, and nuclear weapon development projects. On a bigger scale, we need to address issues such as global warming, fluctuating price of energy resources. I want to see more China working hard on those issues and even taking a leadership in finding better solutions together. So, in the meantime, I will try to change the Japanese politics in order to being able to conduct more strategic foreign and security policies on our part. Thank you very much for your listening. Thank you.